Hi, I'm Bill Houlihan, along with Tom McIntyre and Christine Sack. And we're here to talk about 35 years of television in Peoria.
35 years isn't old, if you're a tree, they say, well, or if any one of the three of us. But 35 years old is how long television has been in Peoria.
So we thought it would be a fun idea to take a look back at how we got our start here and show you some of the old faces other than Hoolies, of course. So if you'll join us for the next hour, let's take a look at the way we were. 1953 was the year that the Odewald family of Mapleton had a celebration of sorts, the first triplets born locally, three girls. 1953 was the year the Korean War was winding down. 1953 was the year Havana, Illinois was celebrating its 100th anniversary with beards and bonnets. And while some were humming, "How much is that doggy in the window?" this man was inspecting a television set, because 1953 was the year WEEK-TV came to Central Illinois. That wasn't to say people didn't have TV sets, but to get anything, you needed a pretty big antenna and some luck.
I know I personally had a 100-foot tower.
Merlin Hindert is a pioneer TV and radio dealer now wintering in Florida.
And our stations closest was Chicago, Davenport, and St. Louis. And it seems that they had put all three of them on the same channel, Channel 5. So when you would finally get a real good night that you could get a picture, why, you'd wind up getting two or three of them all at the same time, and then it would look like you were looking at the picture through a Venetian blind.
So there was a good deal of anticipation. After months of building and planning, WEEK-TV went on the air February 1st, 1953. The first thing anyone saw...
You were the first guy locally to go on the air.
Yes.
What exactly did you... You had a... Was it... I was told it was a Western movie that you introduced, among other things, that
day. It was. It was John Wayne in Stagecoach, and I did the Motorola commercials without any teleprompters. We memorized the script. And I still remember that it was glare down, sound up.
And across the river in Peoria was this man.
My memory of that certain Sunday in 1953 is still as fresh today as if it had been just last night. It seemed like magic, that first night of broadcast on Peoria's first television station. Being able to watch television in sparkling black and white, unlike those fading snowy images we had watched at friends' homes, coaxed from faraway Rock Island or Champagne, by a huge tower of an antenna. That was real excitement. Bill Houlihan, live from all the way across the river, hosting a showing of John Ford's Great Western Stagecoach. And little did I know, as they say, that that evening would begin a 35-year association with WEEK. As a viewer, then an employee, and now as someone permitted friendly entry from New York to Peoria area homes by Channel 25.
Going to a friend's house to watch TV wasn't all that unusual. Sets were expensive. This one sold for more than $600. But then you got a record player and a radio as well. The radio may have been a good idea, since there was a lot of time in the beginning when WEEK-TV wasn't on the air.
We had just been on the air weeks, literally, and it seemed like every day we're scheduled to go 8 or 12 hours on the air, and some darn thing would go wrong with the mechanism, and we'd have to tear it down, and the engineers would start all over again.
When it was on, you could watch Fulton Sheen on Life is Worth Living.
And if we put ourselves on God's side, we may be sure that in 15 years, communism will be as forgotten as Nazism is today. Why, with God, we have already won! Only the news has not yet leaked out.
For Groucho Marx, on You Bet Your Life.
Welcome to You Bet Your Life. Say the secret word and divide an extra $100. It's a common word, something you always have with you. Phyllis Diller and George Diller. No, Phyllis Jarvis. No, George Jarvis. Phyllis, I'll start with you. Now, where are you from, Phyllis?
I'm from Lima, Ohio.
According to the first week's schedule, To Be Announced was also a heavy favorite. Those first programs were delayed a week or more. WEEK-TV was showing NBC, CBS, and the Dumont Network, and delaying their programs by a week or more. On Tuesday nights, however,
every Tuesday night,
the whole country watched Milton Berle.
Oh, gee, silly, boys and girls. the television show is going commercial from Hollywood across the nation.
This is John Cameron Swayze.
Everybody's heard about Hop Along Cassidy.
Hello there.
Annual Christmas parade in 1953, WEEK was broadcasting with a network line. Peoria's got to see the Shrine East-West game live. And speaking of sportscasters, that's the next segment.
Five years ago this month, three guys, Bob Arthur, Chick Hearn, and yours truly, Bill Houlihan, stepped in front of this camera for the first time. We brought television to Peoria for the first time ever, but even more than that, it was the first time that any of us who were working for WEEK Radio at the time had ever stood before a television camera. Obviously, we made a lot of mistakes. We loved the people here in Central Illinois, and they finally learned to like or love us. And we had a lot of fun along the way. And the purpose right now is to have you join us as we celebrate 35 years of television and let you share in some of the fun we had. Just to bring you up to date, Bob Arthur, the first TV anchorman in Peoria, is still in the business. He's broadcasting in Los Angeles on KABC Radio, and he's keeping busy. This week, he's on the road in Florida. Next week, he's taking his radio talk show to Australia. Chick Hearn, the first sportscaster, is now the voice of the Los Angeles Lakers.
Hi, everybody. This is Chick Hearn speaking to you from Los Angeles, California. But really, my home, radio and television-wise, is Peoria, Illinois. That's where I really got my feet wet in this business. And I want to thank all the folks that are and have been associated through these 30 years with WEEK-TV for the opportunity. And thank you, ladies and gentlemen, out there in the TV radio land that accepted our work while we were there for five wonderful, never-to-be-forgotten years. And when we think about the early days at WEEK-TV, the thoughts that I get, driving, trying to get up the Springfield Road Hill over there during the winter with the ice and the snow. Bob Arthur and Houlihan and myself and many, many others had the pleasure of being the first on-the-air people on Channel 43, and believe me, it was a thrill, it was a test, and I'm glad to say that seemingly we all passed it.
And I got the job of weatherman.
Okay, in 1951, Mac, I decided to get out of radio. I already had four children. Every time I wanted to get a raise, I had to move to a larger market, as you well know. You just couldn't get a raise anywhere. And I said, the heck with it, I'm going to go flying for a living. So I went to work for Byerly Aviation. I earned a commercial pilot's license and a flight instructor's rating. Now get the timing. I got my commercial license on September 11th of 1952. And as your picture pointed out, they broke ground here on September the 16th, which was my 29th birthday in 1952, okay? Fred Miller called me in the office and he says, Houlihan, you're the only guy on the staff that knows anything about meteorology. You're gonna be the weatherman. And that's how I got started in the weather.
After 7 years, Bob Arthur left Peoria, and a fellow by the name of Chuck Harrison joined the staff. Chuck and I and Mac had a chance to reminisce about the old days and the fun we had then.
Now, Houlihan keeps talking about how loose things
I beg your pardon?
As a place.
Who's that?
Houlihan, tall fellow, white hair, Big Bill.
No, never heard of him. I had to say that. The day would have been ruined if I hadn't said that. I remember I would close a newscast and hope that people will have a good night tonight, a pleasant day tomorrow. And as I was doing my last story, standing at a kind of a lectern, all of a sudden the lectern started to move. So I took a step, and the lectern kept moving. I took a step, took a step, took a step. Finished the newscast, almost hysterical, but I managed to keep my composure. There was Houlihan on the floor with a wire, pulling it, pulling my lectern away from me, which shows the meanness of this man. He did it only because some person in jovial good taste had taken a blowtorch the night before and gone outside where there was a weather station. And at the proper command, this person went out, lit the blowtorch, and held it under the thermometer, and it was about 15 below zero. And all of a sudden, the temperature, as he turned to give the temperature, went up to about 75. So he was just getting even.
Early on, the real early on, the fun that we had, everything was live, as you know. I mean, from 2 minutes to six until 6:30, the camera went on in the studio. It never went off in the studio. If we had a half minute or a 1 minute film during that whole 32 minutes, it was a miracle. So everything was live. You did your show, you walked down the studio, you did your commercial, talking all the way back. And then you had a guy like Hearn, who I used to have cards that I'd pull out and say, here's the forecast for today and here's the one for tomorrow. And invariably I'd open it up and it'd say Chickie was here, or it'd say almost anything. You never knew what either one of us was gonna do to each other, you know?
It was loose.
It was loose.
Now, that did not happen very often. It happened, and it was fun. We had no rules. We had to make them as we went along.
Houlihan has said that he didn't know a TV camera from a doorknob when he walked in the door. It was all kind of learning by as you went.
I imagine it took him a long time to learn what a TV camera was like. I'd say 31 seconds.
But people talked about it, and it was all live. They didn't tell us we couldn't do it, you know. But we did have fun, and people talked about it. People still talk about it, about some of the things we did back then.
And then there was a scarier moment, when our tower seemed ready to come down.
I was at home, and I heard this voice of an engineer, it certainly wasn't one of the announcing staff, saying, WEKLZ, do technical emergency, boing, and the picture went blank. So I dialed the in-house number, the unlisted number, and Swede Nelson answered the phone. I said, Swede, what the heck is happening out there? He said, can't talk, tower come down, click. So I was dressed, I hadn't gone to bed yet. I dashed out to the car, hit the highway, and as I looked at the tower, it was there. And all the way out, I watched that tower. 30 degree arc in each side, stood not out in the lawn, across the street, if you please, along with Swede and a number of other employees. And we sweat bullets because any moment we thought that tower was coming down. Ken Toffanelli's got that all fixed.
Yeah, luckily that's no longer a problem for those of us who are still working underneath it.
But it did happen.
And in the news business, there was a serious side to Chuck's memories.
Then there was the murder trial of a man who killed eight nurses in Chicago.
Richard Speck.
And the Richard Speck trial came here. And that was one of the most awesome stories I have ever covered. The sadness of the families who came to see the trial of the man who had butchered these nurses. I don't think people know two things that will always be in my memory. One, the judge who called the reporters in and said he was setting up a gag rule. He wanted a gag rule so that reporters would not say anything that would allow Richard Speck to win on appeal of his murder conviction. That was before the trial ever started. An interesting comment by a sitting judge. The other thing was the demand by Richard Speck that he have artist's equipment in his cell so that he could do some painting. And I don't think it was ever reported that he did paintings in the cell. And those paintings damned him without any question. The obscenity, I don't want to go into detail, but those paintings never saw the light of day, and they described the mind of a murderer who was terribly ill.
Chuck retired from broadcasting this past year. His place at the station had been taken by Tom Connor.
Good evening, everyone. Thieves got away with an undetermined amount of rings, watches, and jewelry.
My life, as so many others, is much richer because of knowing him and learning from him about journalism and television and so many other things. The thing about working at WEEK was the chance to learn from people like Tom, to learn by doing, to practice, but always with the insistence that you got it right.
Get the crowd into the ball game like it's been the last couple of nights.
And Chick Hearn, well, Chick just keeps on going.
Give you scores of all the other games being played. around the league. There they go, picking on Chick again.
That's life.
Well, somebody has to.
All the people say. You're right.
You heard the phrase, the TV generation, the group of you that grew up with television. As it changed from an oddity to an entertainer, keeping kids occupied on those long, cold winter afternoons. Well, we have two members of the TV generation on our staff, Kelly Morgan and Lee Hall.
That's right, Mac. Television was a large part of our childhood.
And it was always there, but we did more than just watch TV. TV really came to us.
Before TV, children looked to books and radio for heroes. And so when television came along, it was no surprise that it would supply them hundreds of heroes.
When WEEK signed on with the Six Gun Theater, Western stars were the heroes of the day.
One TV hero, the Cisco Kid, really came alive here in Peoria.
He greeted his little fans in person at Expo Gardens.
TV wasn't just for the younger kids, Kelly. You and I grew up with American Bandstand, but for teens of the earlier years, there was Hooley's Hi-Fi Club.
It was a program sponsored by Coca-Cola that started first on radio and then came to television. And our own Hooley was the Dick Clark of the day.
At the time, I think I was 34 or 35, and I was just the right in-between that I could demand respect from the youngsters, and yet I was close enough to their age that they kind of poured their heart out to me, you know. Their folks were old fogies, although they were only like 10 years older than I. It was live music, it was records, Mac, and we had, from 1957 to about 1960, we had 200 youngsters in the studio dancing every Saturday. And we had all the biggies at that time, the Paul Ankas, and here live, whenever they would come around, they would always, that's kind of a show they wanted to come to. Actually, the Hi-Fi Club was a national Coca-Cola radio program, but experimentally, one in Pennsylvania and us, they put on television to see how it went. And it went for 3 years, every single Saturday. And, for example, four young men came to me from Woodruff High School who were an a cappella quartet. And, they had started out as an a cappella quartet, and then one of them learned how to play the bass, and one of them learned how to play the guitar, and so on. They called themselves the Spotlights. And I managed that band, and I had bought an old Cadillac from Wilton Mortuary, and we fixed up a trailer, and those four guys, drove all the way to California, playing, earning their way all the way out and all the way back. One of them is Stan Marshall. It's a Continental Regency now.
Ahoy, mates. This is Captain Jinx.
And this is First Mate Solly Sam.
Join us now for an hour of fun and adventure.
But for all of us kids growing up here in Central Illinois, the most memorable entertainment on TV of all, Captain Jinx and Solly Sam.
All our mateys, Captain.
Salty George Basilian has passed on, but the captain, Stan Lonergan, is alive and well, and so are his memories.
And I'll bet you didn't know Stan Lonergan wasn't the first Captain Jinx.
His idea. Well, they had this fellow who was a disc jockey on radio, and they got him to do it. And incidentally, he did it very well. I would watch him do it. Well, now he, after a short while, he got a call to go to Chicago. Go to work for a station there, and so he left. Well, it was kind of up for grabs, and somehow or other they needed somebody to fill the bill, and I think they auditioned two or three other people along with me and decided maybe I looked more like the fellow who just did it. I don't know.
Well, you know, in the bit with the goat was actually not supposed to be there. He just butted in.
He just butted in. We're gonna see you in just a moment. Just butted in.
Oh, another gem, Captain.
All of us kids love the captain, but occasionally a well-meaning youngster could do some innocent harm.
It's a beautiful picture of a Christmas tree, right, Captain?
Boy, that bird's going to get really out of hand, you know.
Beautiful.
A couple of them would come up, you know, and pull the beard. That's not real, is it? Sit down, boy. You know, they pull the beard. And that was one thing. In those days, I did, I suppose I can say this now, I wore a pasted-on beard. This one I have now is real. My nose isn't real, but this is real.
Oh. Now, Captain, you know what time it is.
What time? Now, let me see.
You don't have to look at your watch.
No, it's a little home.
It's time for the joke
barrel time. And oh, one of my favorite spots.
And they're all down there. They're going to start laughing.
Okay. All right, I'll just...
Remember the joke barrel, Kelly?
Oh, sure, I sent in many jokes.
Yeah, me too. And I have a feeling they were probably as bad as this one.
This one comes from Kathy Twitty, who is 9 years old. And here's the joke. What did the porcupine say to the cactus?
What do you get when you use... banana peels for shoes, and the punchline is, well, you get a pair of slippers, you know.
Yeah.
So, yeah, and we didn't get much of a laugh with that.
What did the porcupine say to the cactus?
What?
Is that you, Mama? See, the porcupine.
Most of us couldn't imagine the captain and Salty anyplace else besides on the Albatross.
But there was a time when Stan Lonergan was pressed into service as a weatherman.
As for the weather here in Peoria, generally bad, you know, a little inclement. The rain may fall in Spain, but today it fell in Peoria, on the plains, in the gutters, every place. Now, let's step over here and take a look at the weather map. Well, it's certainly there, isn't it?
I don't know how I got through it. Because, you know, there are certain things I think that you're cut out for and certain things that you're not, and I'm not. I can't find, I don't know Florida from New York on the map, you know.
And we have showers here in Utah. And also in New Mexico and Arizona, which is caused by the low pressure system that causes the showers, or is it the other way around? Well,
I was at home and my wife thought I was having a heart attack. I laughed so hard. I was down on the floor watching. I said, look at this guy. He was wonderful, just wonderful. But Lonergan, you must understand, was sharper than $700. And George, if it would put a script in front of him, he was flawless. When you went to ad lib, the stand would throw him curves that he just couldn't handle.
One of the greatest chefs in the world.
Right.
Just love his chili ice cream. Love it, Jade.
You think we can do this more often? The first few shows, I was really scared. You know, I was, and I was bad.
You know what time it is.
Got over that and just said, I got to where I enjoyed it, and I enjoyed looking, planning things, and then later, Salty Sam joined me on the show, and I just got to where I liked it. It caught on and sailed along pretty well.
But see, that was great, Salty. You think we could do this more often?
We both know the Captain Jinx story very well. We both spent some time out here in the studio audience and met the Captain and Salty when they were around town making public appearances.
I guess Captain and Salty will probably always be our favorites. And after all these years of watching, we finally get to set foot here on the deck of the Albatross. Ahoy, mateys.
One definition of news is change, reaction to change, fear of change, rejection of change. Nowhere is change more evident than when it comes to the changing technology of news gathering. When WEEK-TV first went on the air, those early news and sportscasters had only black and white still pictures to show. But when film came, movie film, Well, then started the revolution. It's a revolution that continues today. If you go into the attic of many homes, you'll find the cast-offs, the unneeded, the memories. It's the same here at WEEK-TV. The changing technology of television news has left things like this, a Bell & Howell 70DR silent film camera up here in the loft. Once upon a time, in the early days of television news, this was the mainstay for getting black and white film and later on in color. Film of this 1964 running of the Indianapolis 500, for an example. Or the 1967 trial of Richard Speck.
You can do everything but bake a cake with this. I would like to know which stories this camera has covered in the Peoria market.
The films were spliced together onto one reel. And when there was a late story and all your film was on one reel, well, it was indigestion time. Mechanical cameras were replaced by electronic cameras. At least then, one late report wouldn't jeopardize a whole newscast. When it comes to a changing technology, most folks probably don't really care how we do it. It's the technology of their TV sets at home that may concern them more. And for that part of the story, we've got to go into yet another attic. Koss Radio in Peoria has been selling electronic equipment since 1919. That's a lot of equipment, a lot of TV sets over the years. And upstairs in the Klaus warehouse in a dusty recess is this old dandy. It receives only channels 2 through 13, VHF only. But it's what's inside the TV set that's interesting. Tubes and wires. By way of contrast, this is a 1969 model RCA, a model 2000, the first fully transistorized television set sold in the United States. It also cost $2,000, but then again it came with this nifty, if somewhat bulky, remote control. Since then, microchips, that's them at the bottom compared to a penny, have made electronic equipment lighter, more capable, more complex, and cheaper. A home video camera today can do things professional news cameras of only a few years ago couldn't do. Satellite trucks like these have allowed WEEK to watch the Iowa caucuses at night and have the story for the 10 p.m. news.
I'm Tom Brokaw.
News gathering used to be limited to the immediate vicinity. Videotape pushed back our deadlines. Now, satellite technology will allow News 25 to go to Atlanta, Georgia and New Orleans for the Democratic and Republican National Conventions, for the local news. And that's something only the networks were doing just a few short years ago. The Nixon-Kennedy campaign was the first so-called television campaign. In 1960, Jack Kennedy came to WEEK-TV. It was a time when people were still believing other people didn't shoot presidents. It was a time when presidential candidates met people who hadn't been cleared by the Secret Service. 20 years later, when Ronald Reagan came to that same TV studio here in East Peoria, it wasn't to do an interview, but to videotape a message that would be seen across the country. All that preceded by a rally in Peoria, designed largely to show network TV cameras that Mr. Reagan was being cheered in America's heartland.
Good evening, John.
The increasing sophistication of television equipment and TV audiences means that where once network crews alone followed the candidates, now local news crews do the same. Campaigning becomes more candidates meeting the cameras.
That's right, Bruce?
That's right, but of course some...
Maybe we spend too much time worrying about the gadgets.
That's what I was going to ask you. Is there too much emphasis put on the technology of being able to get the news and not perhaps so much about the way it is presented?
I thought about that a lot since the first phone call, knowing that I would be coming here. And I cannot answer that. I don't want to see television news go back to the good old days. They weren't all that good. They weren't as good as they are now in the complexity of information that is delivered instantaneously. We could cover stories 100 miles away back then, and we'd have it on the air the next day. But you got a funny looking dish out in the parking lot, and you can carry a story live from anywhere in the world in a matter of seconds. I don't want to see us give that up.
It's easy to reminisce about the way things were
it's easy to say that, you know, well, those were the good old days. Things were looser, things were more relaxed. There wasn't the pressure.
True. It was a different kind of pressure. It was pressure that we put on ourselves. We did not have, everything was simplistic. A few seconds of silent footage, and you went out and covered the story, wrote the script, and that was it. Now, with video and audio material meshed in a very precise order, rather complicated order, you can give much more impact, and I think you can give a little more depth. The problem is that the newscast of 20 years ago gave more stories. The newscast then gave fewer features. It concentrated more on what had happened an hour ago and 6 hours ago and just took the top of the story. Now you go into much more depth, and that's good.
Hugh, where were you today? Jesse?
Is that IP?
Simon.
I'm fine.
All day.
Well, that's good to see you.
How was he today? Where was he?
Austin, Sioux City, and Des Moines.
I presume you see me, but I can't see you.
Yeah, he's good.
Even if we wanted to, it's not likely we could get rid of all that technology and all the things it spawned, the mini cams, the mini recorders. And besides, being honest, as toys, they're a lot of fun, especially for somebody who once carried around a Bell & Howell 70DR.
Television, it seems, is ubiquitous. From those first beginnings in 1953 in Peoria, well, you can find a television almost anywhere in town today, even inside a limousine. Right, Tom?
Absolutely right, Tom. Cute guy. Talk about lifestyles, the rich and famous. All kidding aside, television in America now is ubiquitous. From those beginnings in Peoria 35 years ago, it's hard to imagine what life would be like today without it. When you talk about the impact of television on people, well, you've got a very broad subject, suitable for doctoral theses, big books, and perhaps more than one one-hour special on television. The impact of television is, after all, on the individual. We thought it might be interesting to talk to a young woman who called us and said, I grew up with Channel 25, and she did. She was just across the street from us. We decided to find out what she remembered of Channel 25 and what she thought about what went on here in those days gone by.
I think so. It was something special, secret to me, something that I could have as a secret, that I kind of knew what was going on. Where I know.
Meet Joyce Hemphill, self-described pest, at least at one time. She grew up in East Peoria, next to this TV station. If there's anybody who's a member of the TV generation, it's her. The station was already on the air when she and her family moved in, and she and the station grew up together.
Gravel driveway was not really the ideal conditions to learn to ride a bike. So my parents would bring me over here to the TV station driveway because it was nice, paved, smooth, and I would learn to ride my bike on the driveway.
But there was a lot more to do than just ride a bicycle when you live next to a TV station. Remember Chuck Harrison's description of how the tower was swinging around?
The police came to the door and was evacuating the neighborhood, and across the street they had a big searchlight following the top of the tower as it swayed back and forth. And the police came, evacuated the neighborhood, and I remember being in the back of the car late at night, you know, it was dark, and watching the light shine on the tower as we drove down the road, and I spent the night at my grandma's house in Peoria.
Bergner's reminds you, school starts soon in central Illinois. Buy everything you need.
That's an early Bergner's commercial. If it seems a little, well, funny, 20-odd years later, it was a ideal item for show and tell at school.
In the back of the station, they have a big, at least that time, had a big bin where they would discard old commercials. And every now and then, I would take a walk out behind the station and see what commercials had been tossed aside. And there was one day a friend and I came over and we hit the jackpot. I mean, we had, I don't know how many grocery bags full of commercials, discarded commercials, and we were in junior high at the time. And we took them to school and the science teacher spliced them all together. And we had maybe 2-3 hours of nothing but commercials. end on end. And of course, that was a big thing. Lucas' class loved it.
When 1960 rolled around and Jack Kennedy came to WEEK for an interview, well, just guess who was on hand as well.
I remember a lot of people being back there. I remember him coming out. I remember shaking his hand. And then my family has pictures of it, but just a lot of action, and everybody seemed enthused by him being there.
For those who don't remember, wrestling was a mainstay on WEEK for a while, live, behind the building, or in the studio.
Outside, and my family would come over occasionally and see some of the stars there.
And of course, there was Jinx and Salty.
But I would come over and ask the receptionist if I could come in. Sure, come on in. And I would. I'd sit there, watch the show. And then the station would then have a half-hour break to show the NBC nightly news, the evening news. And during that time, I would then talk with some of the people from the Captain Jinx and Salty Sam, as well as some of the newscasters, some of the cameramen. They would show me how the cameras work. They would show me how the weather map worked. I would go back to the news area where they were doing the writing. I would go to a control room. I would go see where they were preparing films for the weekend, for the weekend movie, and just actually to the inside of the station.
So, of course, with all that background in television, Joyce Hemphill, bright and fluent, went into the business, right?
No, it never entered my mind when I went to school, went to college, to go into entertainment as such, or into media or communications. Although,
then again, she's got her PhD. Living next to the station didn't do her too much harm either.
For the last 10 of WEEK-TV's 35 years, we've been proud to work with the Methodist Medical Center and the local St. Jude affiliate in the fight against children's cancer. It's become a personal program that brings our whole broadcast family together here at WEEK-TV. It's a public service that grows every single year. Our own Lee Hall, who does the sports on weekends, deepened his personal commitment to the kids of St. Jude with his special, Every Step You Take.
Impossible, but it moves into its sixth year of helping the children of St. Jude's. The runner's long and grueling journey from Memphis back to Peoria is 4 days of pure agony. Agony not unlike the children's, but theirs continues. There's hope. Hope that someday the St. Jude run and cancer will be nothing more than memories.
Lee's special is a good example of television's alter ego, the other side of TV's strict news and entertainment lineup. It's called Community Commitment. It's the hours and hours of time spent preparing and broadcasting programs designed to better the towns and cities in which we live.
This year raised $110,842.
This summer, WEEK-TV will broadcast its 11th St. Jude Telethon, but the community commitment doesn't stop there.
Kelly, nice to see you.
Nice to see you too,
Lee. We're ready to get going for an all-night and all-day tomorrow session. And we're shooting to raise a lot of money for children.
I can't think of a better reason to stay up all night than to raise money for our kids right here in Central Illinois.
And
another growing project for WEEK-TV is the Children's Miracle Network Telethon. Hooley and Kelly Morgan host their third telethon late this spring. This effort enjoys national support from the Osmond Foundation and dedicated local support from St. Francis Medical Center.
Are we almost ready to look at that final total?
Are we ready to look at the final total?
I think so. All right, let's go.
Are you
ready
for this?
Let's see it.
Let's look at it. 131,093.
Oh my gosh.
We go over the top, huh?
We really outdid ourselves this year, didn't we, Hooley?
I think so.
Boy, everybody here in Central Illinois has a lot to be proud of, and the celebrating is going on.
Let it go.
A lot of reason to be happy. Thank you, Central Illinois. Bye-bye.
Goodbye, all.
Freedom now for our POWs and MIAs. Let's get them home.
And if it were within the power of these people, that would have been done on this day.
When we're not raising money, we try to raise your consciousness.
At the end, a lone drum cadence. The names of those who fell in Vietnam from Central Illinois were read by WJBC's Steve Vogel, a man who'd been instrumental in putting today's celebration together.
Last Memorial Day, McLean County vets asked for an end to the bitterness and called home the veterans of all wars.
And Chris, this Veterans Day parade is probably the largest of its kind ever in downstate Illinois. An estimated 8,000 veterans from World War I, World War II, Korea, and Vietnam turned out, along with some 40,000 spectators along this parade route.
Veterans came not just from Illinois, but from all over the country. For one group, the parade wasn't the first leg of their march. It was the last on a journey that started 60 miles away. This News 25 special profiled McLean County's stirring tribute to its fighting men and women.
What happened here today and at memorial ceremonies all around the country this weekend is a reminder of a debt that is owed by all of us. Never confuse the camaraderie of soldiers with the love of the situation that brought them together. The smiles are for those who came through a terrible experience intact. The tears are for those who did not.
Community commitment takes many forms on WEEK-TV. However, you'll see our best work in that area on the evening news. It may be helping the disadvantaged learn how to get their homes repaired, showing the jobless where to find retraining, or relaying the needs of one big and growing Central Illinois family. Almost daily, we present the stories of how people can help others, and the work goes on. Hooley and Mac join me in a moment for a final word.
Those of us whom you see on television are only the tip of the iceberg, just maybe the 8 or 10 reporters, sports announcers, anchors, weekend anchors, and what have you. But believe it or not, there are 85 people on this staff at WEEK Television, and they come from all walks of life, and there have been hundreds and hundreds of them over the past 35 years.
And they're in the production department, sales department, engineering, accounting, traffic. They all work behind the scenes to get us on the air. Like Hooley said, probably 1,000 or more have made WEEK TV their home, at least for a while.
And probably most of them were greeted by our longtime receptionist, Jeannie Meyer, who's still greeting people out there. Well, to all those people and to all of you, we hope you've renewed some old acquaintances and had some fun over the last hour. We'll be back on News 25 Nightside. And, of course, 25 at 45 in 10 years or so. Good night.
Good night.